Good morning.
We're glad to have you in our service this morning. Trust that you've had a very good week. Look forward to coming today. Today is a very special day. All Sundays are very special, but today is a very special day in the life of our church. We come and celebrate communion, and so we're glad that you've chosen to be here today. And I know that you'll go away from this place saying it was good to be in the house of God. If you take your bulletin and look at it, you'll see some things that are going on in there. We'll try to make sure that you know of the different things. Deacons, meeting this afternoon at 5 o'clock, take care of the business of the church. So, guys, you'll be here. We'll do that. Then following our service tonight, we're going to have an ice cream social. We encourage you to come, be involved in that. What is the number one thing you need to have if you're going to have an ice cream social? That's a sharp group here. Good. Ice cream. And so it doesn't just appear in the fellowship hall. Somebody has to churn it and bring it. So we would encourage you to churn a churn of ice cream and to bring it with you tonight. We do need another churn or two. And so if you're going to come and making ice cream is something you can do, we would encourage you to come and bring a churn of ice cream. If not, we'll take what ice cream we have, divide it up and eat it. And when it's done, we'll go home. And so you're encouraged to come participate in that this afternoon, immediately following our evening service. You see that we have another wedding shower coming up, Hannah and Brandon getting married. And so we've got that shower coming up August the 13th. Put that on your calendar. Remember that. We've got another wedding coming up here in just a couple of weeks for you to attend and be involved in. So Richard and Emily will be getting married Saturday week or 2 weeks from yesterday, however you want to say that. And you have a special invitation to come and join with them and be involved in that happy part of their life. We have coming up in August Sunday school workshop. It's going to be at First Baptist Church Leesburg. It is the 20th of August. That's a Saturday. It will start at 8:30 and be done at 12. It will have breakout sessions for every teaching group. I plan on being there. I would encourage you, if you're going to teach or be involved in the work of the church next year, to make your plans and come. It's absolutely free. It's provided for by Mallory Association. And put that on your calendar, if you will. And in conjunction with that, it's time to start getting our teachers and officers, workers of our church up for next year. Last year, we simply attached the thing on the bulletin board with your name on it. And if you didn't want to teach again next year, you would have to go and scratch your name off and we'd find someone else. This year, we're doing something different. I have the list of folks and it is absolutely blank. It has nobody's name on it. And other than a couple of things that are already generated by our church laws, constitution, there's no names on that. And so for you to teach next year, and we want you to, we want you to keep your position, but you'll need to sign the list and put your name on there. We want you to teach. We need teachers. We're going to need more teachers. And we want you to want to teach. And so the list will be put up on the bulletin board after the deacons meet this afternoon. We'll go through it, add some names in there that we're responsible for. And then this is going to go up on the bulletin board, and we'll start encouraging you to sign up and then get involved in the Sunday school conference that's coming up in August. Each fifth Sunday, and this month has a fifth Sunday in it, we use that Sunday as an encouragement. And the offerings that are taken that Sunday goes towards the building fund. If you've been across the street, you know we're well into the progress. I believe all the painting is done except what touch-up will be needed after the flooring and other stuff are added. And the lights for the sanctuary are in and are working. As a matter of fact, I think all the lights in the church are now working. We don't have the tiles in yet. But they'll be going in soon, the ceiling tiles. And the air conditioning is on and working, so we are well along the way of completing the project across the street. But there's still funds needed for us to complete the project. We are borrowing from the loan that we have available, and we are beginning to take money out of that, so we will be owing money for that. And we wanted to do this project without any debt. And unless some money is given, we will wind up with a small amount of debt before this is over with. The way to avoid that is for us to give. We had a good start, We've got 33,000 plus a little bit has been raised. We are time that is available that you can spare. We're not asking you not to eat or to do anything like that, but if God has blessed you and you have the ability to give, we encourage you to give. And a good day to do that is a good time to do that is this fifth Sunday morning. And so we will be taking that offering up. We'll be praying that God will provide, and he provides through us. And so I encourage you, if you've already given, thank you very much. We appreciate that. And God blesses you, and you're able to give again. That'll be wonderful. And if you have not given, I would encourage you to think about what God would have you give. I think you'll see once we get completed and get across the street that the money's been well used and that we'll be able to reach folks for Jesus Christ through that process. We're not building a building just to build a building. Yeah, we do need one. This one here has gone past the time that it has been useful. It's been very useful for half a century now, parts of it. It's time to do that. So I encourage you to give, and Fifth Sunday is the time that you'll be able to give on that. Are there any other announcements now that I need to make that I have not made? We did already set the fellowship hall up for the social tonight, so things are ready for that. Do pray for Leslie. She is done. She is one of our church hosts, and she had to have some surgery Friday, and she is at home recuperating from that. So if you have a chance to drop her a card, a call, and let her know that you've been praying for and thinking about her. As you know, Sean Freeland passed away last week, Scott's brother, so continue to pray for that family and grieving process. Had the funeral yesterday for Sean. So we've got some folks in our church family that are hurting. We've got some coming up for surgery next week. And so I'll be praying for those as these things happen. Well, we're glad you're here this morning. I know we're in the middle of summer, and I know that we've got folks away on vacation. We've got some folks back. I was away there a week or so ago, and we were glad to get back. And so that's part of what we go through during the summertime. So we're glad that you're here. I pray that those of our way will enjoy, have a good time, and get back safely as soon as they can. So let's stand, have a few moments of fellowship, greet those round about you.
Who's got a birthday in July?
Roy Powell.
Birthday's in July.
All right. All right, let's sing our happy birthday song.
Somebody's gonna get married.
I ain't got one.
Oh, I'm
sorry.
Me.
I didn't see Mitchell out there, so
he's
I didn't.
He's not out there. He's from sick about it.
Yeah. You are being taken up there.
I am.
Let's say congratulations to Tanya by herself.
Church.
All right, our first hymn, number 526. 526, let's all stand.
And turn with me to the first book of the Bible, Genesis, and the 28th chapter. Genesis chapter 28. This is a fairly familiar story to most of you who have been in church for some period of time, and looking across this congregation, I would say that's the majority, if not all of us. Jacob and Esau have had their differences. Esau's birthright has been stolen. And now Jacob is going to run from the land. He is going to receive the blessing and do that. So you'll recall what is taking place there. And then the story inside of chapter 28, I think, once I read it to you, will be familiar. Then Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and charged him and said to him, "You shall not take a wife from the daughters of Canaan. Arise, go to Padan-Aram, to the house of Bethuel, your mother's father, and take yourself a wife from there of the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. May God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you, that you may be an assembly of peoples and give you the blessings of Abraham to you and your descendants, that you may inherit the land in which you are a stranger, which God gave to Abraham." So Isaac sent Jacob away, and he went to Padan-Aram to Laban, the son of Bethuel, the Syrian, the brother of Rebekah, the mother of Jacob and Esau. Esau saw that Isaac had blessed Jacob and sent him away to Padan-Aram and take himself a wife from there, and that he blessed him and gave him a charge, saying, "You shall not take a wife from the daughters of Canaan." And Jacob had obeyed his father and his mother and had gone to Padan-Aram. And Esau saw the daughter of Canaan that did not please his father Isaac. So Esau went to Ishmael and took Mahalath, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Naboth, to be his wife in addition to the wives he had. Now Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. So he came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. And he took one of the stones of that place and put it at his head, and he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached the heaven, and there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac, and the land of which you lie I will give to you and your descendants. Also your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south, and in you and in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. And then Jacob arose early in the morning and took the stone that he had and put at his head and set it up as a pillar and poured oil on the top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel, but the name of that city had been Luz previously. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and keep me in this way that I am going, and give me bread to eat and clothing to put on, so that I may come back to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God. And this stone which I have set as a pillar shall be God's house. And all of you that, and all, say it again, and of all that you gave me, I will surely give a tenth to you.
Amen.
Dave Walton, will you lead us in prayer? Children, if you'll meet Mandy down front for children.
Good morning.
Looks like we're not going under there.
No, not today. We have communion stuff set up on there today, so we have to be really careful.
If you go under it, you cannot automatically stop.
That's right, and we don't want to do that, do we?
And the fields are bright.
That wouldn't be good, would it?
Yeah.
Okay, so thank you. So today we're going to talk about the words that we use. And there's all kind of words that can be used, right? There's nice words and sweet words and mean words. And we don't want to use mean words, do we? So today we want to talk about kind words. Ryder, can you sit up for me? Be a big boy. Sit up. I know. Me and you both. So the verse I want to talk to you about today is from Proverbs. And it's Proverbs 16:24, and it says, kind words are like honey, sweet to the soul and healthy for the body. That's interesting, isn't it? That kind words are sweet to the soul. How can words be sweet? Y'all know how words can be sweet to the soul? Well, what does sweet mean when you think about taste? It means it's good, right? It means it's nice. Don't you like it when you get a treat, like you get a sweet treat? How does it make you feel?
Good.
Does it make you feel, especially if you get it from, it's unexpected. Say your mom, you get picked up from school, and your mom has a sweet treat waiting for you. What does that feel like?
Happy.
It makes you happy because you know your mom loves you, right? And she cares for you, or your dad, whoever picks you up from school. Could be your grandma or granddad. So how can kind words be sweet to you? can make you happy, can't you? If somebody says a kind word to you, it can make you really happy and make you feel good inside, right? What about if somebody had a kind deed to them? How can that be? How can that be sweet? Can it be healthy or unhealthy? It can be healthy, right? Because it makes you feel good, and especially say someone say you're at church and you're playing, and your friend fell down and bumped their knee, and you stopped and you checked on them, and maybe you rubbed on it, helped, like got a little dirt on it, and you rubbed the dirt off for them, and told them you hope they feel better. That can make them feel good too, can't it? That's why what it means is good for your body too, because it not only makes you feel good for doing it, it makes the other person feel good for doing it. So sometimes, you know, I don't know if y'all ever see things that maybe you don't understand and people aren't being kind to one another, but what we need to remember is that it's always important for us as Christians to be
broken.
Okay, don't pull on it then. For us as we're going to be Christian and we love God, then we need to be kind to other people just like Jesus and God loves us, right? Because we want to show that same love to everybody that that we meet, right? We want to show them that not only do we love them, but we love them because God loved us first. And the way we can do that is by using kind words and being sweet, because it's healthy for your heart. It makes you happy, and it's healthy for your body too. All right, so let's say a little prayer that'll help us get ready to be kind and generous to everyone. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord God, we just thank you for today. We thank you for our kids, Lord God, that love you, Lord. We thank you for their families that bring them here, Lord God, to love and to worship and serve you, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that you will be always with us and that we will always remember to use our kind words, Lord. Lord, give us opportunities, God, to show other people your love so that we can lead others to you. Thank you and praise you for all that you've done for us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Offshore hymn number 500. Number 500. Let us all stand.
a Sunday or so. We have certainly had a tragedy strike our country. It continues to do so. And I wanted to address the subject and address what is the root issue behind it. We hear a lot of things that are taking place, and I'll do that probably not next Sunday. I'll be prepared next Sunday, but I've got some folks going to be away, and they ask if I'd wait. And so if the Lord wills, I'll wait to the following Sunday. But the truth of the matter is, folks, I'll just give it to you in a nutshell, and then I'll build on it. I'll unpack it here in a couple of weeks. Is when a country loses its moral underpinnings, you can be certain what you see in front of you is going to happen. It is always the case. And unfortunately, I fear that we're just at the beginning. Unless we have a revival and turn around back, what you're seeing now will be multiplied over and over and over again. And so we'll address that here in a couple of weeks, and we'll talk about what can be done about it. It's not enough just to opine. We need to talk about what we here can do about that. But for this morning, take your Bibles and turn with me back to the book of John. I want to finish this that we've been discussing over the last several Sundays now. John chapter 1, I'm going to pick up reading in verse 43, read through verse 51, and try to move quickly through this so we can cover it and then have time to appropriately take our communion time this morning. John chapter 1, beginning with verse 43. If you found that in your copy of Scripture, would you please stand in honor of the Word of God? The following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We found him of whom Moses and the law, also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Nathanael said to him, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered and said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, you will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Amen. Thank you. May be seated. Our Savior now is in a very important part of his ministry. He's calling out those men that he's going to fill with the Word of God. They're going to see him walk his ministry there in Israel. They're going to be eyewitnesses to all that takes place. And 11 of these men are going to begin the process of spreading the gospel and building the church. He calls 12 apostles, one of whom we know was not for real. And then he calls at least 70 other disciples to help along the way. And so we know at least that many, probably more, from the Word of God. It's a very important thing, the men that he's going to choose. He does not choose like normal men would do so. He does not look for the affluent. He does not look for necessarily those that appear to be the most prepared. He looks for men who are usable, men whose hearts can be changed by the Word of God, men who, though they'll go through a period of doubt, they'll go through a period of uncertainty, they'll go through a period of confusion, when they come out the other side, they will be men that are on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. He goes to an area that he's familiar with to call these men out. It is an area around the Sea of Galilee. There are many small villages, hamlets, towns that are around that. These men are predominantly fishermen. They have trades that they're involved in. And it's among those people he begins to call out those. We've already briefly talked about. He called them by the River Jordan, there where they were following John and Simon Peter. And he also called there most likely John, though John does not mention his name himself there. He travels back to the region of Galilee. That's where we come to this the following day. Now, that's the day after he gets back. It was about a 3-day walk from Jordan back up to the region of Galilee. And so that the day after that, Jesus continues with this process of calling out individuals, men, who he's going to use in this work. And he does so. He comes there and he calls Philip and he says, "Follow me." Now, here's the first words that we're going to look at. We're looking at these words of Jesus as he speaks them. He comes and finds this man called Philip. We'll find out a little bit about him in the Bible, not a whole lot, but we will find out some. And he calls him. Philip hears what he's saying, and he begins to follow him. He gives him his confidence. He puts his trust in him. And we know that because immediately after hearing and coming to an understanding of who Jesus claims to be, and he claims to be no less than the Son of God. He claims to be God come with us. As a matter of fact, to make sure we understand that, he has been given a name, and that name is Emmanuel, and Emmanuel means God with us. That was given to him by the angel at the Annunciation when he told Mary what was going to be taking place, and he carries this name forward with him, and that's a part of who he is. So our Lord, our Savior, is explaining himself to these folks. Philip, along with the others that he's already called here, it pierces Philip's heart, and Philip begins to follow him. Point number one this morning is when God calls, follow. Don't wait. Do what God says do when God says do it. Don't wait. I believe if we are certain that is what God has said to do, I believe if you know that it's the God of heaven that is called, you'll respond. See, the problem today with many folks is they hear a voice, but they're not sure what voice they hear. They hear a voice, but it's not a voice they're willing to follow. They hear a voice, but that voice is an uncertain voice that they hear, and because of that, they're not willing to commit to it. I believe what's taking place in the church in America, at least, we've got a lot of folks that have heard a voice. They have followed maybe afar off, but they're not committed to that voice. They don't do what the voice says. See, when Jesus calls you, he calls you to certainty. He says, take up your cross and follow me. He says, repent of your sins. He says, don't just admit your sin. A lot of folks come forward and they admit their sins, but they don't repent of them. You know what to repent of your sin means? That you admit that there are sins, they admit that they are against the plan of God, and you change your mind about your sins, and you quit doing what you were doing, and you start doing what God says do. See, God has definites. The saved folks have definites that God says, and when God says, follow me, for those that have committed to him, they do what he says. See, today there's folks in the church that are uncertain if they're going to follow God. And in the very simple things, God says that you are to confess before the world that Jesus is the Son of God and that he's your Savior. You know, there's some folks that claim to be believers, but they're not willing to stand up and confess that they are following the God of heaven that came down to earth, became a little baby, grew to be a man, declared himself to be God, nailed to an old rugged cross, buried in a tomb, and rose the third day. They're following a religion, but they're not following a person. You must confess that he is Lord. You must obey. He says those that have confessed openly ought to obey in baptism. One of the requirements this morning for a person to come and partake of communion is they have confessed with their mouth the Lord Jesus and they followed him in believers' baptism. You say, well, preacher, why do you require that? I don't require it. The Bible does. You don't have a right to tell folks that. I know I don't have the right to tell folks that. The Bible does. The Bible says believers are to be baptized. And so if you're not going to follow in a very simple matter, and that is to obey the Lord and follow in believers' baptism, how in the world do you believe you're going to follow him in other things? Now, he may lead you down a road that is difficult. Not all believers go down an easy road. Sometimes the road calls you far is easy. As a matter of fact, God says for believers that they are to come together and assemble together and to worship God together. As a matter of fact, as he says, you see the end of time approaching, this age approaching, we ought to assemble together more often. We ought to do everything we can do to make sure we come together. He says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. That is a command. That's not a suggestion. Believers, folks that have been redeemed, have heard a certain voice and that are following Jesus
follow his commands, and his commands are sure. I don't see how folks get so confused about what God wants a believer to do.
I wouldn't be a good Baptist preacher if I didn't mention God says we ought to give.
Folks that have heard a certain call and that are following Jesus, give. They don't have to be browbeat. They don't have to be embarrassed. They don't have to be arm twisted. They don't have all those things. All they have to do is an opportunity. I want to tell you, when folks fall in love with Jesus and start doing what Jesus says doing, it is not a problem to give out of the storehouse that God has blessed us with. As a matter of fact, I read in the Bible examples of folks that fall in love with the Lord and start doing what the Lord says do. Sometimes God has to tell them, that's enough. Did you know that? There's places in the Bible where folks are so in love with the Lord and so in love with the plan of God, they start giving, and they give so much that God says, well, okay, I got enough. Now listen, I've never been in that place. Not in a Baptist church. Not where when they get baptized, they hold the billfold up out of the water. No, sir, I've never been in that place. So you can have all of me, but my wallet, my money, my finances. And so here, these are things that you ought to be able to look at your life, assess your life, and see if you're a follower of Jesus. Does giving save you? No, but save folks give. Does coming to church save you? No, but save folks come to church. Here's one last example here that I think that shows, this is not all of them, I'm not trying to give you a comprehensive list, we got something to do here in a few minutes, but folks that follow him, that they ask other folks to come and see him. They ask other folks. Look what Philip did. Philip says, now Philip was from Bethesda, the city of Andrew. Philip went and found Nathanael and said, I found him. I found the one the Bible talks about. I want to tell you, one of the things that the church needs to do, and one of the things Antioch Baptist Church in particular needs to do, we need to start inviting folks to come to church. You cannot tell me that in our congregation, we don't have folks round about us in this community that we can invite to come. It's easier not to do that. I know it. I know sometimes we think it's uncomfortable to ask friends and family and neighbors and those round about us if they come to church. But the truth of the matter is, it's going to be a lot more uncomfortable to know that those folks spend eternity in hell because nobody cares about it. It's going to be a lot harder, or for you one day to see those folks in heaven, and they look at you and say, you knew about this. You knew what wonder it was, and you didn't tell me somebody else had to. That might be where some of the tears in heaven come from, by the way. The Bible says it's going to wipe away all tears. It might be some of us that had the opportunity to share the gospel and invite folks to come to church, and we chose not to do it. Somebody else did. They're in heaven, but you missed your blessing. I missed my blessing. See, when folks hear clear call, they'll ask other folks, and I've heard about it. Let me tell you. Come on and see. As a matter of fact, that's what he's going to tell them in a minute. Come and see. I wonder why we don't invite folks to come to our church. I think we've got a good church. I think we've got some good people in this church. Let me quickly say, one of the problems, one of the good things and one of the bad things about a church is, one of the good things is they've got people in it. One of the bad things is they got people. We're human beings. All of us are flawed. All of us from time to time are going to miss the mark. None of us are perfect. But we can live up, and when we find our flaws, God exposes them to us, we can repent of those things and change. And be more like Christ. We've got a good church. We're building a very comfortable church. We're building a church that you can be proud of. You can be proud of this church. You don't need to wait till we get across the street. You can invite somebody tonight. I tell you, tonight would be a good time to invite somebody. You can actually say, we're having ice cream. Who doesn't like ice cream? I'm going to preach first. We're in Timothy. You can invite somebody next Sunday. You say, come on, we got a good church. We got good singing. We got a good choir. We don't have a nightclub, we've got a church. And so, when will we get in love with Jesus and we hear the call enough that we invite others? Follow me. And so, here we say, so Nathanael came to see him. And Nathanael looks, and the first thing he has to say, this is the first Baptist ever. He says, woo, I'm glad to see Jesus. No, he says, can any good thing come out of Nazareth?
Of all the stuff he could have said, he picked out a bad thing. As a matter of fact, by the way, Nathanael is from a little place called Cana. Y'all ever heard of Cana of Galilee? That's where Jesus is going to do his first miracle. That's where Nathanael is from. And it wasn't a big place, folks. It was Tai Tai. I mean, whatever. It was just a little place itself. Man, he said, can anything come out of Nazareth? It was a prejudice that he had against that little fisherman town. Wasn't much a village, at best, is all that it was. And he says, can anything? And then Philip says to him, see, when somebody says, well, I don't know, I'll go to church. That's the only morning I get to sleep, buddy. So we start at 10. More to tell for Sunday school. And by the way, that's just come to church to begin with. We start at 10 minutes to 11. Sleep all the way to 9:30. I mean, you ought to be up by 9. Charlie, they ought to be up at 9:30. Oh, yeah. That's plenty late to sleep. And come on, we're not asking you to get up real early. And come and see. You say, well, there's a bunch of hypocrites down there. Say, yeah, they sure are. But they're working on it.
By the way, they're hypocrites at work.
They're hypocrites in
whatever club you join. They're hypocrites down at the bar. They're hypocrites down at the place you go to eat. That's part of the world we live in, folks. Just come and see. Tell you what, we don't take names and come drag you in if you don't want to come. So come on down and see. See if it's something that you'll enjoy and you want to come back. Just come and see. Yeah, I know it's from Nazareth. He said, I know, but why don't you check him out anyhow?
And so come and see. I know that's a good invitation, isn't it? Somebody said, well, why should I come to your church? You know what you ought to say? Because we got the best preacher in the world. No, you all say, come and see. See what God might do for you. And so so he comes. And when he comes there, Jesus sees he's coming. And he does something I think is tremendous.
He understands Nathanael's temperament. He's been viewing him. You know what he says? Behold an Israelite in whom is no deceit. Our King James says God, means no deceit. Now, did he say that Nathanael was perfect? Was Nathanael a man? Was he born of the race of Adam? So what does that tell us? He wasn't perfect. But he had a heart. He wanted to be right.
And so Jesus meets him at a place. You know, I know this is a tendency. Don't anybody get upset with me with this. This is a tendency for some of us.
Somebody walks in the back door of the church, hadn't been there for some time. What is the tendency for us to say?
It's not going to fall down, is it?
Wow, you're here, amazing. Well, now I want to tell you, folks, that's not the way to greet and influence and help folks.
That's not how Jesus did it. He looked at Nathanael and he said something positive about him. Somebody walks in the back door of the church and they've been in the bar the night before and you can tell it by the look on their face, but somehow God's brought them to this place. You don't look on their body, I bet this will be better in the bar.
No.
They'll say, wow, we're thrilled that you're here this morning. We're glad that you could be with us. If you know something positive that's not a story, don't ever tell stories. You know something positive, you can tell something, say something positive about them and welcome them in. I'll tell you, there's a better chance that they'll ease into that environment that way than if they're looking around waiting for the church walls to fall in on top. And so Jesus says that to him. It's not in the purview of what I want to talk about this morning to deal with it, but there's discussion about this particular passage of how Jesus knew about this. Some believe he's exercising his divinity. And some don't. I personally believe right in this particular place, he is not exercising his divinity. He's exercising his extreme humanity. See, Jesus was raised around this area. And he had seen these guys before. They hadn't paid any attention to him. That tells you something about Jesus and his growing up. They didn't know a whole lot about him, but Jesus knew a whole lot about them. This is not the first time he thought about them. I bet this is not the first time he's prayed for them. I bet this is not the first time that some of these thoughts has come through Jesus' mind. I believe he was, as God was preparing for these folks. And so he says to them this about him who has found faithful, no deceit. Nathanael looked at him, because Nathanael already knows his own heart. And he says, how do you know me? That's a wonderful question. Don't have time to deal with it this morning. Because in Nathanael's heart, if he truly believed this was God speaking to him, he knew that God knew all about him. And I want to tell you, how many folks want to raise their hand and say, I'm glad God knows all about me? I'm not. I'm glad God knows all about me and loves me anyhow. And so he says, he looks at him here, and he says, how do you know me? Jesus answered and said to him, Philip, before you came, you were under the fig tree, I saw you. This is amazing to Nathanael that anybody cares enough about him to have seen him under the fig tree and to know about him. And this is amazing to him, and because of that, he cries out to him and said, Rabbi, or teacher, master, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Now, that shows you that Nathanael's heart was ready to be pierced, and the God of heaven had pierced his heart through the Holy Spirit and identified that this was Jesus. As a matter of fact, the Bible says no man can know him except the Spirit draws him to him. So we know the work of the Spirit was there, the work in Nathanael's heart, and he quickened Nathanael's heart and made him ready. And I want to show you this morning how Nathanael knew that God was speaking to his heart. It's a good thing to learn, and then we'll do communion. He says, Jesus answered, looked at him, marvels at him, and says, because I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? Jesus says, because I could tell you where you were, whether he did it through his divinity or his humanity, is that why you believe? He was questioning Nathanael for Nathanael to look deeper into his life. Nathanael had to realize it was not of Nathanael, but it was of God. And that God had prepared him and made him ready to do this thing. Jesus said, listen, Nathanael, most assuredly or certainly or truly, truly, I say to you that you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. So Jesus meets him. I find out something about Nathanael. Nathanael was under the fig tree. What was Nathanael doing under the fig tree? Well, I cannot be dogmatic about it, but I think I'm pretty certain about it. Nathanael was reading his Old Testament. Nathanael was studying and praying. Nathanael was prepared. Remember, there was a tremendous expectation that the Messiah would come. And Nathanael was wanting to be one of those that would be involved in the Messianic reign. And he had taken his Bible and he was studying it, and he was using the light that he had. That's a great principle there, folks. If you will use the knowledge, the light that you have, that light God will provide, that it will be enough. No man that wants to come to the Father will fail to come to the Father, because if you want to come to the Father, it is because the Father is drawing you to himself. It is the work of God. And so here Nathanael was, though he lived in darkness as an Israelite, though he had not yet come to know who the Savior was, he had a desire, a knowledge to know, and he was going to the one place that you can find out about God. That's the Bible. Him, it was the Hebrew Old Testament. He was reading and trying to gain knowledge. And he'd come to this 28th chapter of the book of Genesis that I read to you this morning. And it was there that he found out that indeed his prayer, his hope was being answered in Jesus. He had been reading about this story that I read to you, that Jacob was running from his brother. He went by the Jordan as he crossed over. I know Brother Robert Vogel's been to the spot where he moved the stone and put his head down there. He went down, he lay down, and he went to sleep, tired, give out, and afraid. And God gave him a... And he was speaking to Jacob's heart, and he was telling Jacob, no matter what the circumstance, God is in control. If you'll come to the place of God, God will meet you there. And so God opened up a dream, and there's a staircase. I know in our Bible it says a ladder. If you study just a little bit, you'll find out that ladder was more like a staircase, an elaborate staircase, that the bottom was on earth and top was in the heaven. And there angels were going up and down. I don't know if it was a manual staircase or a heavenly escalator. I have no clue. But they were going up and down there on the ladder. And he saw, and when he woke up, he came to himself and he said, this is the gate of heaven. This is the house of God. And listen, Nathanael realized by reading that scripture, God speaking to him, that this was the gate of heaven. That gate is open. Jesus said, I am the door.
No man cometh to the Father but by me. Nathanael saw what the Old Testament had been predicting in forms and shadows and pictures throughout the Old Testament, that God was going to send a way to fulfill all the promises that he had made to mankind. And here Nathanael saw it was the gate of heaven. It was God. The stairway to heaven was in front of him.
At the point of your need. See, the problem today is there's folks that are not responding to the call of God. They declare a want for God, but they don't show any interest in God. Not reading their Bibles, not attending church, not praying, not fellowshipping. Think not that you are going to come close to God. But the moment that you respond, that you give in to the call, the desire, the urge of God, and begin to study and read your Bible, I want to tell you, God will show up. Folks, it worries me when folks open their Bible and read it, and they come to me and say, well, preacher, I don't understand my Bible. I don't get anything out of my Bible. It's not interesting. You know what they're telling me? They're telling me that they're not coming to their Bible to know God. They're coming to their Bible to read. If you'll come to your Bible and know God, God will meet you there. God will jump off the puck. What he'll do from time to time, he'll illuminate, and then you'll be reading your Bible, and you'll turn your radio on to a good gospel station, and that very verse that you're reading, God will step out in song. Have you ever had God meet you in song? Have you ever been studying your Bible and trying to gain understanding of some passage, and the God of heaven, through the miraculous means of a radio or a CD or eight-track, no, that's too long ago, will speak to your need? Or what he's done also in my life, I've tried to study the Bible, I've tried a passage, I've tried to gain understanding of it. You know what God would do? He'd stand a preacher up in front of me, stand a Sunday school teacher up in front of me, and lo and behold, that very passage that I was trying to gain knowledge to, he'd step out of that person's life into my life and speak the Word of God to me. If that's not happening to you, something's wrong, folks. Draw near to him, and he'll draw near to you. One of the ways we have of drawing near to God is this blessed time of communion. As a body of believers, we have the opportunity now to come together and partake figuratively of that sacrifice that was given for us, that we might have life. The very door of heaven, the gate of God, is before us. It's through his broken body and his shed blood. I tell you this morning, the stairway of heaven is before you. And the angels of God are ascending and descending in this place. And we have a way to join into that. As Nathanael heard and believed, you can hear and believe. If you're here this morning, you do not Jesus Christ as your Savior. If you have just been a token member, if you've been outside the family of God, but partaking of some of the inward workings of the church, but it's being a shell and shallow and empty and vain and void, I implore you this morning, come to the gate of God. Come to the only place of hope, and that is partake of his broken body and his shed blood. Ask him to come into your life, and he'll fill you with his Spirit and change your life forever. If you're a believer this morning, and you have been living separated from God, apart from God, you have not felt the power of God, you have not felt the person of God, you have not felt the presence of God, I implore you to come to the gate of God this morning. Come to the stairway where the angels of God ascend and descend, and ask him to pour himself anew into your life, to thrill you, to change you, and then begin to be faithful in the things that he talks to you. And I promise you, your life will not be empty. You will not live a void life, but you can live a life that is thrilled with the things of God.